Oh, stained so spiritually blue. I feel the spirit. Father takes care of all of us. But you know, today is Father's Day, and we are so thankful and happy that we are here today. And I want you to know that Father's Day first started in 1910. And it started in Spokane, Washington. And it was on June the 19th, the third Sunday in June, by a lady by the name of Sonora Smart Dobbs that started the Father's Day recognition, which was to complement Mother's Day. And that was a great, great, great start for us. And also, before I get to my text today and my scripture, I want to tell you a little joke to get you going, to get your mind thinking, to make sure we're all on the same page. And this joke, it's dealing with a father and a son. And I'm going to say the son's name is Bill. And Bill had just gotten his driver's license. And so he was so happy. And if you can think back when you first got your driver's license, how happy you were. And so Bill came to the father and said, "Father, now that I've gotten my driver's license, when will my time be to drive the car? I want to be able to drive. So when can I drive?" Now the father was a pastor of a church. And the father said, "Son, Bill, come on back to the study with me. Before we talk about driving, there's some issues that we need to clear up. Number one is that Number two, you need to start reading the Bible more. And number three, Bill, your hair is just too long. You need to cut it off. So after that, about 6 weeks passed. Bill came back to the father and said, "Father, we need to kind of talk about my driving time. When am I going to be able to drive? I want to drive to the movies. I want to drive to the dry cleaners. I want to be able to drive some." Father did the same thing. Bill, come on back into my study. "Bill, I'm so proud of you. Your grades have improved tremendously. And I'm proud you're studying the Bible more. But Bill, you have not cut your hair." And Bill waiting on, no, the father waiting on a response from Bill. And Bill said, "Father, I've been reading the Bible. I noticed that Samson had long hair. I noticed that Moses had long hair. And I noticed that Noah had long hair. And even Jesus had long hair." So when Bill made his case, he waited for the father to respond. The father responded, "You're right. Samson had long hair. Moses had long hair. Noah had long hair. Jesus had long hair, but you didn't get the whole concept. You read it, but you didn't understand it fully. You notice they walked everywhere they went." Let us get to some biblical studies today. Let's go to the book of Proverbs, where I can pull a text and bring a message this morning. The book of Proverbs, the third chapter, beginning at the very, very first verse. King James Version, it says, "My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck, write them upon the tablets of thine heart." So shall thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruit of thine increase. So shall thy barn be filled with plenty, and thy press shall burst out with new wine. My son, despise not the chastising of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding. I want to go back to that fifth and sixth verse. 5th and 6th verse for a text. It says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to thy own understanding. But in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. I want to use for a subject or a thought, a recipe for fathers. A recipe for fathers. When you think of a recipe is a set of instructions for a set of ingredients to come up with a particular dish that you're trying to make. But the dish we are dealing with today is the dish of fathers, the ingredients that is needed to be a good father. That's what we're talking about today, a recipe for fathers. This text was written by a man the Bible called the wisest man that ever lived. And this man was King Solomon. And Solomon was talking and laying down rules to his son. Solomon had lived the life. He had gone through some ups and some downs, and he was trying to get over to his son the reason and how to live in this life. And he was telling his son, even with all of the wealth that God has blessed me to attain. In other words, Solomon had ships, and he had vineyards, and he had concubines and wives. He had so much material things. But Solomon was telling his son that all of this material things is really vanity, vanity upon vanity without the Lord. And so he wanted his son to know that you've got to have God in your life. So the key to life is being able to identify your problems and put the right recipe and get your problem fixed, get it right. And reading this, after reading the book of Proverbs and going through what I've read for this Father's Day message, I noticed five roles for the father. You fathers that's listening, I want you to apply this to your lives if you hadn't already started. The first role, five roles, the first role is to seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And once you learn to do that, you seek God's righteousness. Then the next role you got is to lead. And you got to lead by example. So when you lead, your family will follow you. And so the next role, the first role is to seek God. The second role is to lead. The third role is to take your family to worship and teach them to pray. Amen. Pray and worship. That's right. Teach your family that. That's right. And then the next role you have as a father is protection. You need to protect your family. You need to watch over your family. You need to guard them. And then the next role you have is to provide for them. Provide life insurance for them. Provide food for them. Provide shelter for them. Give them what they need so they can be a successful person in this world that we're living in. That's the duties of the father. That's a role of a good father. So we see here where Solomon is teaching his children how to do. And that's once you've done that, you need to be able to teach these young boys that you come in contact with to lean toward God. You need to teach young boys to be the right, do the right thing. Remember, there is a God. Teach them if they're wearing their pants too low, teach them to kind of pull your pants up so you can be respected in this community, be able to get jobs and get work. And teach them it's all right to say yes, ma'am, and no, sir. Right. Teach them that good manners will lead them, get them far in life. Yeah. Good manners will take you a long way in life. And also, if you remember my words, the rewards will be long life. And if mercy and truth is the principle in your life, you will find favor. You will find favor with God Almighty. Solomon is telling his boys how to live and how to get by in this world. If you give up your first fruit to the Lord and learn to sow into the kingdom of God, your life will be flowing. God will bless you. God will open up floodgates for you. I'm talking about a recipe for fathers. You learn this recipe, you'll be able to float through life, have plenty in your life, because God will show favor upon you. Am I right about that? And listen, Proverbs. There's two verses in this book that I want to hone in on. And that's the third chapter of Proverbs, the fifth and the sixth verse. And when Solomon was telling them to trust in the Lord. And in other words, once you learn to trust in the Lord and lean not to your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, he will direct thy path. This is good for when you're going through sickness. He'll direct your path. When you're going through hard times, he'll direct your path. When you're going through folk lying on you, he'll direct your path. When you're going through mishaps, he'll direct your path. When you're going through a no job, he'll direct your path. When you're going through without, God will supply your needs. He will direct your path. Solomon was saying, trust in the Lord and see what the Lord will do. In other words, don't trust in your friends, because your friends might mean well, but they don't have the capability. They don't have all the know-how. They don't really receive everything the way it should be received. They may receive a word or a message from somebody else and interpret it the wrong way and bring it back to you. You interpret it your way, but you're not doing it God's way. You gotta be able to discern the spirit. You gotta be able to understand that even though friends mean well, but don't put all your trust in friends. Put your trust in the Lord. And I want you to know, you can't trust your little bit of money, because money can't fix everything. There'll be some things money won't be able to do. So you can't put your trust in money. You can't put your trust in power. Because power might be here today and be gone tomorrow. Am I right about it? The one you knew back then might be dead right now. That power is gone. But the only thing you can put your trust in, that holy power, that's the power of God. God Almighty, he'll never leave you, nor will he forsake you. And I'm going to tell you this. Now listen to me good. You can't even trust yourself. You can't put all your trust in you. Because if the truth was known, if you tell the truth and walk with me, there's something you say you're going to do, and you wind up not doing it. And then you look around and you say, I thought I wasn't going to do that. But now that I'm doing it. So you can't put your trust in you. The only thing you put your trust in is God Almighty. never leave you, nor will he forsake you. Solomon said, when you get to the point in life and find out there is no one you can count on, but I come by to tell you on my way to heaven, there is one that you can count on. I want you to know that if you fall down on your knees, look up toward glory and say, Father, 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 I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdraw myself from thee, whither shall I go? In other words, Lord, if you don't step in to help, I cannot make it. Solomon wants his boys to know that there is a way out if you trust in the Lord. Solomon is telling them, lean not to your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy path. Solomon said, you must learn to even question yourself. When you're making a decision and trying to do right, you need to say, well, now, Lord, am I doing right? That's right. Is this the right way you want me to go? That's right. I mean, have I got crossed up? You need to question and ask yourself. Because now listen, fathers, we have to be honest.
That's right.
Fathers, we have to sometimes come to grips with ourselves. We have to come and speak to ourselves. Because sometimes we may get on the wrong side of the boat. And we need to come and question ourselves. And sometimes we need to come to understand who we are working for. And we need to realize what the Bible says. Tell yourself, when you question yourself and trying to see if you can trust God, tell yourself that in the beginning, it was the Word. In the beginning, it was the Word, and the Word was God. The same in the beginning with God. And everything that was made by God. And everything that was not made by God was not made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. You tell yourself these things. And now you know that nothing was made without God. And you understand that you can trust God. You can go with God. You can talk to God. You can depend on God. You can lean on God. God will never let you down. He will never let you down. So Solomon is making this known that God is everywhere at the same time. God is where he is going before he leaves where he are, where he is. He's always there. And he's never out of sync. He's everywhere at the same time. So God can be trusted. Lean not to your own understanding. Sometimes your understanding is incorrect. Solomon is saying, son, don't make no fast decisions. If you get in an argument, kind of cool off before you do something drastic. In other words, push the pause button before things get out of hand. When you see things getting out of hand, learn to take yourself out of the element. Because, son, I want you to know that there are many people sitting up in jail right now, because they didn't take themselves out of a situation. They didn't stop to give it to the Lord. They tried to handle it themselves. And not only are many people in jail, there are many people in the ground, dead, buried, because they did not stop. They did not pause. They did not wait to hear from God. They went on their own. And I want you to be able, don't go jump fast to judgment. Take time and learn what you're going through. Survey the group. Survey the crowd. Look at them. Understand what you're up against. And one thing, realize that God says, vengeance, vengeance is mine. How many know God will fight your battle? if you just be still. God will fight your battle if you learn the tools you need to fight with. Am I right about it? In other words, you need to move from instinct to discernment. Many times we move and we don't move in the right direction and causes us to be in more trouble. We need to move from instinct to discernment. Instinct is flesh. Discernment is the spirit. Instinct is you. Discernment is God. Instinct is a feeling. Is a feeling. I feel something. But discernment is wisdom. Instinct is I want satisfaction. But discernment, I want what's holiness. Instinct, I want it right now. Give it to me right now. I want to get it right now. But when you have the discernment, I have to be able to understand in due season. If I wait, because the Bible says they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So if I get patient enough to wait in due season, I will get mine. Instinct say, handle it yourself. In other words, you think the Lord is too slow. I need to go on and handle this business now. But discernment tells us, let the Lord work it out. But we need to put on that pause button and bathe in the word of the Lord when we don't understand what's going on. I'm trying to give you the recipe for fathers, how to have a prosperous life and how to lead your family and how to lead your children, how to lead those that are watching you and observing you, that you will lead them in the right way, because we are disciples of the King. We are disciples of God Almighty, and we need to do the right thing. The last Solomon tells his son, in all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct our paths. Meaning to remember God is everywhere at the same time. Wherever you are in life, God made it possible for you to be there. My son, whenever God rewards you, bless you, recognize Him. When you get up in the morning, recognize God. When you go to work, recognize God. When you're looking for a job, recognize God. When you go home, recognize God made it possible for you to have a home to go to. Recognize your wife, your children, your loved one. Recognize God when you think about God. Recognize these things. That God made it possible for you to have some clarity and some happiness in your life. And I want you to know that, my son, the best I can tell you that God is omnipresent. He is everywhere at the same time. Don't ever feel like you are by yourself. You are without God, because God is still right there by your side. You might not be able to see Him, but you can call Him. He's right there. And not only is He omnipresent, He is omnipotent. And omnipotent, He is all powerful. There's no power above God. God has that advancing power. Whatever power He needs, He got it. And not only is He omnipotent, He is omniscient, meaning that there's nothing God does not know. He knows everything. And you can always call on Him. And Solomon saying, my son, if you listen to me, And honor my words. God will direct your path. In other words, God will show you how to get there with less problem and much faster. It took the children of Israel 40 years to get to the promised land. A journey that shouldn't have been no longer than 11 days. But it took them 40 years because of disobedience and not following the word of God. My son, if you listen to these words and prepare your life and follow after the word of God in truth, and as truth is your principle, truth and honesty, that's your principle, God will show favor in your life. And he will bless you. And your bits will run over with the blessings from God. Do I have a witness in the house today? Do I have anybody out there can say that if it had not been for the Lord on my side? I don't know about you, but I can stand flat-footed, bold, and tell you with all of the hills and the valleys I've been through, the ups and the downs, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I could not have made it today. But God blessed me, carried me through the valley. Yea, do I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I shall fear no evil, because thou art with me. How many know God is with you? Don't care what you're going through, God is with you. Take him to the courthouse with you. Take him to the hospital with you. Take him on job-finding job with you. God will always be with you. A recipe for fathers. Fathers, stand up and be fathers. I know you're saying that, some saying, well, I just don't have it. I'm ducking my child support. I'm not doing what I should do. Please, sir, listen to me today. Go to God in prayer. Just as I say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. And tell God that I want to be a father that supports his children. Explain it to God. Say, God, I knew I messed up. I know I thought I was being bad and getting kids, children here and there. But confess it to God. And say, God, I want to be able to support my children. Don't care how many you got. I want to be able to support them. And trust in God. He will give you wisdom. He will give you a means to be able to meet your responsibility. Men don't duck out. Don't hide. Stand up. Face your responsibilities. Be a man. When you be a man, God will stand with you. If mercy and truth is your principle, God will be right there with you. You got to stand on that faith that he's already given you. And watch how he'll lead you. He'll break you out of that valley. He'll help you to support those children. He'll help you to be a better man, be a better husband, be a better father, be a better brother. He'll help you to even be a better businessman. Because God got it all. Acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. It don't get too hard for God. It don't get too hard for him. The harder the better. He can work it all out. And hear my words today, coming from the book of Psalms. Don't duck your responsibilities. Take them to God in prayer. And ask the Lord to help you to be able to accomplish them. After the word was preached today, it may have been someone out there that was touched by his word. And maybe you've been sitting around saying you're going to give your life to Christ. And now is an opportune time. God has made it possible. He has blessed you to be here today. He's given you this opportunity to give your life to Christ. And I want you to know this. You can't fix your life. You can't say, well, I'm going to give my life to Christ when I get this out of the way, when I get that out of the way, when I stop doing this. You can't do it. I'm a living, breathing witness. You can't do it on your own. You have to call God to come in to help you to do it. And if you hear this word, just as I am, without one plea, come just like you are. And we're going to go down to Romans Road. Go down to Romans Road this morning. And the Romans Road is coming out of the book of Romans. And the first one is Romans 3 and 10. Because it says, for it is written, is already written, there's not one, none of us, of our own is any good. There's not one right. Not one that hadn't messed up. But if we go to Romans 3 and 23, it says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So you're not by yourself. All of us have sinned. From the pulpit to the back door, everybody have sinned. I can't point the finger at you. I can't get up here and say that since I'm a heterosexual, you a homosexual, and point the finger at you. I can't do that. Because I might be a heterosexual, but I might be a liar on another end. I might be doing something that all of us have messed up. And all of us is trying to seek heaven for our home. There's no time for no blame game. So after Romans 5:23, we go to 5 and 8. It say, but God commended his love toward us, and that while we was yet sinners, Christ died for us. He died while we were still in our sins. He died while we were still messing up. He died for us. He didn't wait for us to get it right and then die. No, he died while we were still sinners, still messing up. Because he knew, thank you, Lord. Because he knew we couldn't handle it. He died for us. But if I move from there to Romans 6:23, I want you to know, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What I'm saying there, if we stay in our sin, as a job pays wages, sin pays wages too. And the wages that sin pays is death. Sin will lead you to death. But the gift of God is eternal life. And if we move from there and go to Romans 10:9, because if thou shalt confess with thy mouth Jesus as Lord, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So if we believe Jesus died for our sins, God raised him from the dead, and we believe that in our heart, we're saved, we shall be saved. And let's move to the last one, which is 10:13. It says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. Oh my goodness. That's all right there. Whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now those of you who are out there listening that come with just one plea, Raise your hands toward heaven. You're ready to give your life to Christ. And say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you died for my sins. And Lord Jesus, I believe God raised him from the dead. And Lord Jesus, I believe you are sitting on the right hand side of God the Father, perpetuating for my sins. So when my sins come up there, you will tell God that you've already paid the price. And I want you to know that you prayed that prayer with me and believe it in your heart. You are saved. You are saved. And I ask that you find you a Bible-based church that teaches and preaches Jesus Christ. Start going to Sunday school there and learning more about the Word. But if somehow you can't seem to find a church to go to, you don't know where you can go, if that's the case, and you're listening to this church this morning, you've already found your church. And we are here at 1282 Bradford Heights Road here in Gastonia, North Carolina, 28054. You can call me, call the pastor, and my number is 704-864-6222, extension 208. And we can get everything lined up as far as you how to become a member of this church and how you can be very much supportive of this church. And I want you to know that whatever you do for the Lord is still, it's good. And you can't go wrong with blessing what God has put in place. And before we go to how you can give a donation, I want to go to the altar with a word of prayer for those who may have given their lives to Christ while we open the plan of salvation. Gracious Lord, our Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this word today. And Father, we hope and pray that the words, a recipe for fathers, will not fall on deaf ears. We pray that the fathers, the young fathers and old fathers would listen and be able to apply these ingredients in their lives and see how the blessings would turn around for them. And I pray, God, that you bless those who gave their life this morning. And even if some didn't give it, but thought about giving it, and it's working on their heart, thank you for that as well. And I pray, God, for churches all across this land and country. I pray for those, all of those who are listening, all of those who are watching. Father, I ask a special blessing on each and every one. And I ask a special blessing on the members of the St. John's Missionary Baptist Church. And I thank you, God, for giving me the power to call things that are not as if they were. And I thank you, God, for recognizing and honoring my prayers and the things that I pray for. God, I thank you so, so much. And Father, I pray that as we go through this Father's Day, I pray you bless fathers all over this land and country. And I pray, God, that you will instill in these fathers how to be a better father, how to be a better husband, how to be a better son, how to be a better brother, a better friend. Just teach us, Father, the things that we need to know. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. Now, if you've been blessed today and you want to support our little ministry here at the St. John's Missionary Baptist Church, you can also support by giving to Giblify. You can give by Giblify. And I'm not asking you as what to give. You ask the Lord, what should I give St. John's Missionary Baptist Church? And whatever God inspires you to give, that's what you give. And you give it from your heart. Because the Lord loves a cheerful giver. You can also give in cash. You can bring it by the church between 10 10:30 and 11 and give it to our trustees. And then you can also mail it in by a check, or you can pay by PayPal as well. However you give it, God will be pleased and God will accept it. And God will bless your giving. And so I want you to know that stay in touch with the Lord. And I have a couple of announcements that I want to announce before we sign off. And number one, Vacation Bible School here at St. John is starting this week. And so it's going to be starting on Tuesday through Thursday, 6 o'clock in the evening. So if you want to come by, you can get on Zoom and pick us up, or you can come by the church here, because we want to teach the word. But if you do come, bring your mask and all that kind of stuff. We've got to be still safe and protected. And also, we're planning on another event the last Saturday in July. Keep us in your prayers. And it's called Community Awareness, St. John's Missionary Baptist Church. And so we want to have a day kind of like outside and inside, with vendors and, you know, hot dogs and hamburgers. And just let the community know that St. John is here and what we have to offer to reach out to the lost that's here. We want you to know that. So that's our plan. Keep us in your prayers. Keep us where God can use us. Thank you. I want you to hold on. A change is coming. It's going to get better. Just hold on.